Today, we're going to create a custom wallpaper all inside of Affinity Designer. To make a custom wallpaper, the first thing we need to do is make a new document that has the same resolution as the screen we're going to put the wallpaper on. You can press Command or Control N to make a new document. Since I'm using a 13-inch MacBook Pro, I need to make a document that's 2560 by 1600. With our new document ready to go, our next step is to make a grid that we can use to guide us as we make our design. To turn on a grid in Affinity Designer, we just need to come to View, and then down to Show Grid. We've now turned on the default grid that Affinity Designer automatically makes, but we can modify this grid however we want. To do so, come back to View, but this time press on Grid and Access Manager. We're going to turn off the automatic grid. Then, we can set the grid spacing to 100 pixels. Now we can close the grid in Access Manager. Next, we're going to make triangles running across the top of our document, which will turn into our wave pattern in a minute. To make our triangles, we need the Pen tool. You can select the Pen tool from over here, or just press P on your keyboard to activate it. If you're new to the Pen tool, I recommend you check out our Beginner's Guide to Affinity Designer in the video description, where we cover all the most important tools and techniques in Affinity Designer, including an entire chapter on the Pen tool. We also need to make sure snapping is turned on. To turn snapping on, just press on the big red magnet at the top. Also, check inside the snapping menu and make sure Snap to Grid is turned on. Now that we have the Pen tool out and snapping turned on, I'm going to click on the grid to lay down my first node. Then I'll move two diagonal spaces up and to the right and click to lay down my next node. Then I'll move another two diagonal spaces and lay down my third node. I'll continue the same process all the way across the grid. When you reach the end of the grid, I recommend you still make one more triangle. Even though this will go off the document, our grid will still help us snap our node into place. The reason we're making a triangle that goes off the document is to give us greater flexibility down the road. By having our pattern run off the edge, it will allow us to move our pattern a little to the right or left later on, without our pattern ending abruptly. Now, we're going to lay another node a little ways up. We can hold down Shift to keep our node perfectly straight in line with the last one. Then, we'll make another node way over on the left side. And then, we'll make one more triangle on the left side of our pattern by placing a node that's two diagonal spaces from the first node in our pattern. Then, we can click on the first node to complete our shape. We no longer need the grid, so we can go back to the View menu and turn off our grid. Next, we're going to take our triangle's sharp points and round them. To do this, we'll need the Corner tool. You can find the Corner tool right over here, or press C on your keyboard to activate it. The Corner tool allows us to change the corners on any object. In this case, we're going to use it to round all of these sharp corners. First, though, we need to select the nodes that we want the corner tool to affect. This is really easy to do. All we need to do is click and drag, and we can make a selection marquee that goes around all the nodes we want to affect. Now, we just need to click and drag on any of the nodes. This allows us to round a corner. And since we have all 15 of our triangle's nodes selected, all of them will be rounded at the same time. For this design, you can make your corners as round as you want. Now we're going to give our shape a fill color. I've already chosen the colors I want to use for this design and turned them all into swatches. If you want to use the same colors as me, I've left a download link for my swatches file in the video description. After downloading the swatch file, just come to the swatches panel and then press on the drop-down menu at the top right of it. Then we can go to Import Palette and import it as a document palette. I'm going to use the first orange color to give my shape a fill. And we no longer need a stroke on our shape, so I'm going to select its stroke color and then press on the No Fill button to turn off its stroke. Next, we're going to continue our pattern by duplicating our shape. You can duplicate a layer by pressing Command or Control J. To move our new shape, we need the Move tool. I'll press V to select the Move tool. With the Move tool, you can click and drag to move the shape around. Or, better yet, you can use the Transform panel for laser precision in your movements. I'm going to move my new shape 175 pixels on the Y-axis. For your own design, you might decide to move your shape more or less than this. My only recommendation is to be consistent and move each one of your duplicate shapes the same amount. That will keep your final pattern looking clean and crisp. We're going to give our duplicate shape a new color now. Click on its fill circle to make sure you're changing its fill and not its stroke, and then fill it in with our second swatch color. As you can see, our pattern has a slight problem at this point. Our duplicate wave is covering the original one. Fortunately, this is easy to fix. All we need to do is rearrange our layers. We're now going to duplicate our wave a few times to finish our pattern. Once again, press Command or Control J to duplicate the layer. Then move it 175 pixels on the Y-axis. Now, as long as we keep our object selected, we can duplicate it again, and our duplicate copy will move another 175 pixels on the Y-axis. This is called Power Duplicate. It's a very useful feature in Affinity Designer. We look at multiple examples of power duplication in our Beginner's Guide to Affinity Designer, which you can check out in the video description. Now it's time to color all of our objects. I'll make the last layer I duplicated the second to last swatch color. And just as before, I need to rearrange my layers so this blue object isn't covering everything else up. I'll continue adding colors to each of the objects and then rearrange them in the Layers panel. At this point, we can group our waves. Just select all of the layers by holding down Shift, and then press Command or Control G to put them in a group. Now with this group, we can use the Move tool to resize it and move it around. For the bottom of our wallpaper design, I'm just going to make a rectangle and then fill it in with our dark blue color swatch. I like to leave the bottom a solid color so that I can still easily see my application dock on my desktop. That's my personal preference, but you can make waves all the way down to the bottom if you want. Finally, we'll make one last finishing touch. We're going to select all of the layers inside of our group and apply a layer effect to them. To apply a layer effect, we need to press on the FX down here. In this dialog box, we'll come to the Bevel and Emboss section. From here, we'll change the type from Pillow to Outer. Then we can make our depth radius bigger and add a little softening. I'll make my radius 15 pixels and my softening 1.5 pixels. Then we can close out of this box. I'll press the Escape key to deselect all of my layers. After applying our layer effect, our waves now have a little bit of depth to them, which I think looks quite nice. We're now done with our custom wallpaper design. Thanks for watching, my friends, and I'll see you in the next Affinity Revolution tutorial.